Hello, my name is Alejandro. I'm going to present the paper "Novels in the Trace Attack on ECDSA and RSA." It is a joint work with Billy Bromley from Tampere University, Finland. The content of the talk is the following. First, an introduction on sidechain analysis to binary GCD-based algorithm is presented. Then, we develop a sidechannel attack against NVDLS binary GCD implementation that will be used to mount two novel single trace attacks on ECDSA and RSA. These new attacks are the most important contributions of this work. Traditionally, exponentiation and scalar multiplication algorithms have been targets of sidechannel analysis. However, it is also important to protect other primitives that handle secret data, like the binary GCD-based algorithm. This algorithm and its variants for computing modular inverses have many use cases in cryptography. For instance, RSA scheme has at least this Turing key generation, while ECDSA uses the followings during a signature generation. An interesting case is the last RSA one, where both algorithm inputs are secrets. Sometimes inversions are added to an implementation as part of countermeasures, like for instance the inversion of the mass as a response to the paper return of the hidden number problem. Therefore, consider the many use cases, it is important to analyze the implementation regarding sidechannel analysis and deploy the required countermeasures. The implementation of the modular inversion primitive in NVDLS follows these steps. Note that there is a GCD computation before the actual inversion is computed using the BEA. This property allows an adversary to develop a sidechannel attack against the binary GCD primitive and reproduce it for every GCD or modular inversion computation in this library. The binary GCD primitive implementation is very similar to the classic description with some optimizations. This algorithm has four conditional instructions, green boxes, that depend on the algorithm inputs. Following previous work notation, the control flow information of this algorithm can be encoded using two variables, ZI and XI. Therefore, an attacker that wants to recover the inputs will aim to gather base or ZI XI for some algorithm iteration. Some leakage models have been proposed to describe how to relate the control flow information with the algorithm inputs. These models are independent of the use case of the algorithm. In 2007, the all-or-nothing model was proposed. This model required knowledge of the entire control flow information, that is, the result of all conditional operations. With this information, it can recover all the input bits. It is important to highlight that this model does not require that one of the algorithm inputs is not in advance. 10 years later, the partial model was proposed, offering more flexibility. Using this model, an adversary can recover some information on the inputs using only partial information about the control flow. Nevertheless, the applicability of this model when both inputs are unknown was not done before, a gap we filled in this research. Using some leak about the execution flow, it is possible to apply the partial model, obtaining a recovery equation like this one. The recovery equation relates some less significant bits of both inputs U and V. Naturally, when one input is known, computing the other is trivial, as is often the case in many use cases of this algorithm. Among the advantages of the partial model are, it requires less information to recover all bits of a secret input than the all-or-nothing model. This implies that this model reduces the influence of uncertainty and noise in the legal information. In the remaining of this talk, two novel attacks on the CDSA and RSA are described. The research is framed in controlled channel attacks on NVTLS applications deployed inside Intel XGS enclaves. Intel XGS is a technology that provides confidentiality and integrity to software running on modern Intel processors. The threat model of this technology assumes that the OS has been compromised. Controlled channel attacks belong to a very interesting research field where the adversary can use OS resources to control the execution of the victim. XGS STEP is a framework for mounting controlled channel attacks on Intel XGS enclaves. It can be used to develop fault and interrupt-driven attacks. A fault-driven attack on memory page granularity allows to track the sequence of executed memory pages. Thus, in considering that ABC are tracked pages, a trace looks like this. Interrupt-driven attacks augment previous leakage, providing information about the number of executed instructions at each tracked page, obtaining a trace like this one. The latter offers more information than the former, but it is more susceptible to noise. Using an interrupt-driven attack, we developed a sidechannel attack on NVTLS binary GCD primitive. We capture 1,000 traces for random node inputs and recover the control flow information for each trial. We observed a plus minus one error in instruction counts. However, as we detail later, it is possible to deal with it. In this regard, the recovery of every set I was perfect. However, we observed some error in XI. To overcome this noise information, we developed a procedure to mark some XI as unknown, considering that every unknown XI will lead to two algorithm input candidates. While following this procedure, we observed fewer than 10 unknown XI per trace, and only one trace had an erroneous XI. This data suggests that the recovery of a secret input using this attack can be efficiently done, expecting a high success rate. Now, let's take a closer look at the noise source that produced errors in XI. In this graph, it is shown the XI-related instruction counts over algorithm iterations. It is clear that there are groups of pairs that have the same number of instructions. However, some cases are outside these clusters. This is a code snippet of the comparison function that led to these numbers. It can be seen that there are several early exit points, and sometimes they are very, very close, like these ones. This proximity and the error range sometimes produces erroneous XI. Fortunately, it is easy to detect them and mark as unknown XI, reducing the probability of observing erroneous XI as summarized in the previous slide. After presenting the generic binary GCD attack on NVTLS implementation, we are going to develop a novel attack against ECDSA. This is the linear part of ECDSA signature generation procedure, where the unknowns are highlighted in red. The modular invasion of the known K is computed. Therefore, this computation should be protected against sidechannel attacks. One strong countermeasure is to mask these nodes using the following procedure. A secret mask M is randomly generated and used to mask K. Then, the input of the modular invasion is saved to be leaked, and afterwards, the mask is removed for correctness. However, the implementation always has the final word. In NVTLS, this countermeasure is implemented using these steps. Note that NVTLS does not reduce the product that masks K. For that reason, the input of the modular invasion algorithm is not protected as expected. A deep inspection to the modular invasion primitive in this library confirms that the input of the GCD primitive is the non-reduced product. To know how the unreduced product leaks information on K, let's use a toy example. Let's consider that K equal to 15 and the attacker knows A equal to mk equal to 60. 60 is composed by these prime factors. Thus, it is easy to see that the product with one factor permutation will be k. Next, let's generalize this procedure. The function over omega yields the number of prime factors of an integer with multiplicity. In our example, it is 4. Then, the number of candidates for k is 2 to the power omega. However, it is important to know how this procedure scales. The distribution of this function has been studied for large integers, and it has a log-log mean and a narrow standard deviation. This means that it's very likely this function will be small for modern CDSA key lengths. Therefore, the security of the CDSA relies on factoring the product mk. The worst case for 256-bit CDSA is when both m and k are primes. This is equivalent to break RSA 512, which has been demonstrated in practice. For extensive experiment, we built our own factoring machine. The details about the use algorithm and configuration can be found in the manuscript. For extensive experiment, we captured 1,000 traces and extracted the control flow information of each binary GCD instance. The median of MK candidates per trace was 4. The median of the factorization time was only 14 minutes, and the median number of scalar multiplication for testing a solution candidate was 129. Hence, the running time on the attack is small. Regarding the success rate, it was possible to recover the current nonce in 99% of the cases, demonstrating attack effectiveness. The other attack developed as part of this research target RSA. Specifically, the computation of a CRT parameter, inverse of Q modulo P. Every time a private key is loaded in MBTLS, this modulo inverse is computed. This computation involves the same binary GCD primitive analyzed before. This use case is very interesting. It's interesting because both algorithm inputs are secret, but make it interesting for evaluating the partial model application in this scenario. For our experiment, we target RSA 2048, which can be broken by this quality, one prime or half of it. Recalling, if an adversary knows the control flow information of all iterations, they can recover both inputs using the auto-nosing model. On the other hand, the application on the partial model in this scenario is an open question. Let's assume that some side-channeling attack to a binary GCD implementation reveals the execution flow for the first T iteration. Applying the partial model, the adversary can obtain an equation that relates some bits of P and Q. Then, using the RSA identity, it is possible to obtain a quadratic equation that depends only on P, which solution will give information on P. It can be proved that this quadratic equation has at most 16 solutions. Consequently, if sufficient bits are recovered, an RSA implementation will be broken using this procedure. This example shows how the partial model can be used when both inputs are known. Naturally, this is specific for RSA. However, we are not aware of other binary GCD model invasion use case where both inputs are known. We launched the attack 1,000 times, obtaining a success rate of 99%. Hence, the attack is very feasible. The following table provides a comparison about the number of candidates for P considered in different leakage model of grid analysis. Employing the all-or-nothing model implies gathering the world execution flow information. This maximizes the chance of unknown XI. Besides, also, the number of candidates to test increases, it remains practical. Note how the partial model can be used for both full and half prime recoveries, minimizing the number of XI, of unknown XI. It is worth highlighting the number of candidates to test for all models are in practical domains. However, for such challenge signals with a higher uncertain noise rate, the difference between the models plays a crucial role. As an output of this research, we contacted MBTLS reporting our findings. Afterwards, they recognized the vulnerabilities and developed the following workarounds. For CDSA, they implemented the countermeasure correctly, while for RSA, they only compute the CRT parameter it is not present in the private key, reducing the attacker chances. The main conclusion of this work is that it is important to keep in mind that countermeasure implementations must strictly follow the math descriptions, especially because a wrongly implemented countermeasure offers a false state of security. The attacks on the binary GCD primitive highlight the need of the full stack secure implementation. Regarding the partial leakage model on binary GCD based algorithm, it was shown that it can be used when both inputs are unknown. Additionally, it reduces uncertain and noise influence. Thank you very much.